Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Everywhere I Look, written and read by Helen Garner.
Part 1. White paint and calico. Whisper and hum. When I was in my 40s, I went on holiday to Vanuatu with a kind and very musical man to whom I would not much longer be married, though I didn't know it yet. He was at ease in the Pacific climate, but I hated the tropics with a passion, all that sweating and melting and shapelessness and blurring. And what I hated most was the sight of a certain parasitic creeper that flourished aggressively, bowing the treetops down and binding them to each other in a dense, undifferentiated mat of choking foliage. I longed to be transported at once to Scotland, where the air was sharp and the nights brisk, and where plants were encouraged to grow separately and upright, with individual dignity. At nightfall, the whole population of the island would walk into town, and so would my restless husband and his discontented wife. In velvety air and under a starry sky, a stream of people padded along a sandy track, quietly chattering and laughing. One evening, a Melanesian man in torn and baggy clothes was walking on his own in front of us. He seemed to be cradling something small against his chest. Occasionally he lowered his face over it. We heard faint rhythmic music, and when we passed him, we saw that he was playing a tiny stringed instrument, strumming it very softly as he swung along by himself in the cheerful crowd. He wasn't performing or wanting anyone else to hear what he was doing. He was playing just to keep himself company. I wanted one of those instruments. I wanted to hold it in my arms. I crushed this longing with my usual puritanical savagery. You're too old. You couldn't even learn the piano. You have no musical talent. You'll make a fool of yourself and everyone will laugh at you. Pull yourself together, woman, and slog on. But when we got home to Melbourne, I took down the Oxford Companion to Music and looked up the ukulele. It has four strings and a very long fingerboard. It was patented in Honolulu in 1917, from which date it gradually became popular in the United States amongst people whose desire to perform was stronger than their willingness to acquire any difficult technique or their desire to make intimate acquaintance with any very elaborate music. So, it was a cop-out for the lazy and talentless. I went straight downtown and bought the first one I saw that didn't look trashy. It was made in Czechoslovakia and it cost $45. I also bought Mel Bay's You Can Teach Yourself Uke. I put them in a cupboard under a pile of blankets and said nothing about them to anyone. Whenever I was home alone, I would rush upstairs and take the uke out of its cardboard box. It was so intimate, so un-awe-inspiring, with its curvaceous waist and pretty metal frets and creamy tuning pegs. A faint perfume drifted out of its woody little body. And unlike the hulking piano, which years earlier had brought me to my knees, it was small. No one could possibly be afraid of this instrument. I fell in love with it. I spent secret afternoons sitting on the bed, strumming my way through the beginner's book. I learnt Row, Row, Row Your Boat and Camptown Races. It was easy. It was natural. Four strings, four fingers. Not like a guitar where you're ganged up on every time you try to make a chord. I found I could learn a three-chord song in about 30 seconds. It dawned on me that there are several million three-chord songs in the world, many of which I had effortlessly, long ago, stored in the mud at the very bottom of my memory. Up they came from the depths, dripping and sparkling, so fresh, shining with common human feeling. And I saw that the ukulele, despite the snotty entry in the Oxford Companion, has in fact a simple and benevolent purpose, to create a gentle bed of sound for the human voice, to enrich the single line of melody that a human voice is capable of. Somewhere in the background of all this, my marriage crashed and my daughter grew up and left home. Next time I looked around, I was living in Sydney with a severe modernist to whom the presence of a ukulele in the house would have been an outrage. With him, it was Wagner or nothing. Even a string quartet or a solo piano was too minor. I had to put headphones on to listen to my funk tapes. It wasn't a dancing kind of marriage. How it flew past. Ejected, I scrambled to my feet in Bondi Junction Mall, dusted myself off, and got talking to a woman who was busking on a chunky little thing with a round body. She said it was called a pineapple uke and that her brother imported them from Hawaii. She gave me his phone number. Oh, my kamaka. It was so beautiful that I hated to put it away in its case. Even the wind wanted to play it. One day, when I'd left it lying on the back of the couch and gone into the next room, the faintest, airiest twangling sound reached me. I ran back and found that a breeze coming up the hill from Bondi was puffing over the windowsill and drawing the hem of the calico curtain back and forth over the open strings. Fast forward. I'm a grandmother, back in Melbourne, where I belong. I've owned a ukulele for 30 years, and I'm still a beginner. A uke is humble, but inspires in me no ambition, no duty or guilt. It's so low in the hierarchy of things that the bullying superego can't touch it. I play it only when I feel like it. After a particularly introverted winter, I got to the point where I could play All of Me and I Will very slowly. But everything I learn, I soon forget. I have to keep starting again. I can't pick, I can only strum, and I don't care. Sometimes I hold the uke on my knee while I'm reading the paper or waiting for the kettle to boil. I love it as I would any harmless little creature. I love to hear it whisper and hum. Once in a while, the money-making musicians in my family kindly call me when they're playing in the kitchen after tea or at somebody's birthday party or in the back shed that my sister calls her adobe hacienda. There might be three or four ukes, a harmonica, a mandolin, a guitar. The chords aren't ones I know. The changes are too fast. Someone pushes the chart to me. I take a breath and throw myself into the river. No one can hear me, so it doesn't matter if I flounder. But if I don't panic, if I keep calmly swimming, sometimes I hit the current and it carries me to the end of the song. Some furniture. At the turn of the millennium, I reached the end of my masochism and came home from Sydney with my tail between my legs. Single again. Tenants were still living in my Fitzroy house, and the one I rented for myself in Ascot Vale was too narrow for the table I'd had trucked down the Hume. I offered it to my niece. She turned up with a bloke in a ute, and away they went. I stood in the bare room. What can happen at the kitchen table when you haven't even got one? A woman on her own can easily get into the habit of standing at the open fridge door and dining on a cold boiled potato. I was determined to be elegant in my solitude. But for lack of a table, I had to eat off my knee on the couch. The available space in the kitchen would take only a round table, and every round one I saw, in the crap shops I drifted through at High Point, had a hole drilled in the centre for an umbrella. It chanced that a school friend of my daughter's was married to a woodworker. He came over, measured the spot, and returned in a couple of weeks with a perfect little creation in pale timber. It was so beautiful and so expensive that in my demoralised state I felt unworthy to sit at it. But I forced myself. I learnt to eat dainty salads off it, to nibble at fillets of fish steamed in ginger. This would be my single life. A year later, I took back my old house from the tenants. The kitchen was a large room. The little round table floated on its expansive floor like an autumn leaf on a lake. How could something so lovely look so silly, so out of place? I rolled it into one of the bedrooms and drove down to the fashionable recycled timber shops on Johnston Street. There I found a rectangular dining table of a suitable size. Until I bought my tiny round one, now superseded, I wouldn't have paid four figures for a table in a fit. But the sign said it was made of jarrah that had been salvaged from a demolished warehouse. Its dimensions were pleasing. It had slightly tapered legs and a glossy top on which I could imagine setting out white crockery, cloth napkins, perhaps a vase of flowers if anything pretty ever blossomed again in my garden. For a moment I was puzzled by certain dark nail punctures that randomly pitted its surface. All the furniture in the shop seemed to have them. Maybe this was how recycled timber was supposed to look. Was the very purpose of this noble endeavour to preserve the traces of proletarian toil? Who was I, a self-pitying bohemian, to question this? It looked all right in the kitchen. Its top gave off a warm, dark glow. One day, when I trudged in from work and dumped my red backpack on it, the two colours united in a fiery moment that made my mouth water. I looked out into the grassy yard. Perhaps a bird might alight and emit a musical phrase. Something moved behind the lemon tree. I stepped over to the window, and a hawk beat up into the air with a bald corpse hanging from its beak. I rushed outside. The grass behind the tree was thickly strewn with feathers. I knew that I was in despair. The house was empty, too big for me to fill. All I could bring to it was an enormous, slow, bleak loneliness. In a junk shop, I found a shabby but surprisingly comfortable old sofa covered in gold brocade that was bleached almost to silver. When I delivered it, I saw only its dated gentility. But then I tossed an equally ancient pink silk cushion onto it, and the pink and the faded gold sang to each other in quiet, tired voices. I saw that living alone, one must play out one's domestic dramas through inanimate objects. Suddenly, this did not seem so terrible. But the man who had made me the little round table called in one afternoon. He stopped at the kitchen door and contemplated the recycled Jarrah table without expression. Then he clicked his tongue and said in a tone of reproachful pity, "Oh, Helen." I supposed it was the nail holes. He refrained from a detailed critique and I brazened it out. After he left, I got down on my haunches and had a look at the table's underside. I couldn't believe what I saw. The thing was cobbled together in the most shamelessly bodgy way. Random offcuts of raw pine, still sprouting ragged splinters, had been crudely jammed into its corners and stapled to brace it. No attempt had been made to hide the gross construction. It was blatant, insulting. I tore off the jagged spikes with my bare hands, then pulled up a chair and sat at the table till the back garden got dark. A married friend, whose house was notable for its quiet sophistication, came that week to visit me, bringing a bunch of flowers. She admired the table. I said, "Have a look underneath." She crawled under it, crouched there for a moment, then scrambled out and took her seat. "Got vodka?" I took the absolute out of the freezer and found the shot glasses. "Let's drink to your table," she said. "Oh, don't tease me. I've been ripped off. I want revenge. I want a refund." "Look at it this way," she said. "It's stable, isn't it?" "It was." "Is it the size you wanted?" "Perfect size." "Fits the room?" "It did." "Think about it," she said. "It's an image. Of you. Of all of us. It stands steady. Doesn't wobble. It's extremely serviceable. Okay, it's got those nail holes all over the top, but they're marks of experience. And when you look underneath, you can see it's been pulled together out of whatever was to hand." Maybe it was the vodka. But after a moment's silence, I decided to take her analysis in the spirit in which it was meant. I arranged her flowers in a suitable vase. Then we threw back another shot, leaned our elbows on the dark table's gleaming surface, and took up once more, at the point where we had left it last time, our endlessly interesting, fruitful and entertaining conversation. White paint and calico. The night before I left my Fitzroy house forever, I sat down, exhausted after a day of packing and carrying, to watch Super Nanny. I found myself consumed with disproportionate rage against the barbaric brothers she was trying to tame. Three plain, fat-faced little slobs with prison haircuts and bare, flabby torsos. The parents were divided and ruled by these brats who swore, spat, sneered and smashed things while their silent, obedient 10-year-old sister drifted about in the background, forgotten. I longed to spank the boys and slap their faces. Any fool can see that at such a strained moment, These characters were acting out aspects of myself, engaged in their eternal struggle for dominance or recognition. But at the time, I thought I was only having a fit of the nameless emotion, testified to by everyone I've asked, that explodes in the heart and brain of a person who is about to move house. Oh, I hate the sorting.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.